All right, welcome to the fifth in the LaRouche Pack Basement Galaxy Project class series. We'll be continuing our discussion directly off of the last class. But maybe just to briefly review, so we've looked at getting a sense of our solar system's position in the galaxy. We got a sense of how we're moving in the galaxy. Maybe, you know, admittedly not 100% perfect precision on that, but we have some idea about how our sun is definitely moving with respect to other stars, and some idea of how our sun is moving around this entire giant galactic system that is our home, that we're a part of. After that, we took a brief examination last time on how we're seeing throughout the history of the records we have of the Earth, long-term development of the Earth, we see evidence for how our climate system on Earth has responded and reflected the changing relationship of our solar system to the galaxy, which kind of, you know, opens up an interesting and important perspective, recognizing that we're not here in the galaxy as something out there that we're observing as some other thing. We're in it, we're part of it. We experience the galactic climate. We experience the changing galactic climate. That what we experience here on Earth, the processes here on Earth, the activity here on Earth, is at least in part, in certain parts very significantly, a direct expression of our galactic system, our galaxy. So if we want to understand our position on Earth, in the solar system, in the universe, we have to understand at least our position in the galaxy as well. Now, today we're going to kind of take another step and look at this, look at other evidence for processes on Earth, the development of processes on Earth, specifically life, the development of life itself expressing a resonance with or influence of our larger galactic system. And this gets to, I think, some very frontier and very interesting questions. But to understand this, to understand how the development of life on Earth, the evolutionary development of living processes, expresses a relation to our galaxy, I'm just going to look back real quick at some of these cycles we looked at last time, just to familiarize ourselves with these cycles of our solar system's motion through the galaxy. And last time, as we discussed how this is on the one side expressed in changes in climate. So we talked about what we might call this bobbing motion above and below the galactic plane, which has a period of about 30 million years, give or take, tends to change cycle to cycle, but in that range, we believe about a 30 million year cycle to go from, say, the northern, our transition up to the peak of our northern excursion above the galactic plane, down through the disk, the thickest part of the galactic disk, down to the furthest extent of our southern reach. That's about 30 million years. Or you could count it from midplane down to peak, back up to midplane, that's also 30 million years. Or you could count the cycle, one full cycle, so from southern extent up to northern extent, back down to southern extent, obviously that'd be 60 million years. And what we see in the climate record is a very interesting correlation between long-term records of ocean temperature corresponding with this 30 million year cycle. Things tend to cool when we travel through the galactic plane. They tend to warm up when we're either above or below the galactic plane. So that was one cycle where we see the conditions of the Earth, the Earth's climate, expressing something about our relationship to the galaxy on this 30 million year bobbing cycle. We also saw that we have very, very large-scale changes in the Earth's climate system corresponding to the passage of the solar system into and out of our galaxy's spiral arms. So another somewhat cyclical process of our solar system traveling through our galaxy. We tend to periodically pass into and out of these spiral arm structures, roughly about 140 million years from spiral arm to spiral arm. Obviously changes between passages, different arms, but that's generally what is believed the cycle is. Those are studies that have been out there for a little while now. In 2005, a team out of Berkeley, California, re-examined records of life, of evolution. And we'll get into what some of this means in just a minute, but they looked at this record of total genera. Genera is plural of a genus. A genus is one stage above a species. So you could, if you're not familiar with genera, you could just think of the total number of distinct species basically existing in the fossil record at any given time over the past half billion years, past 500 million years. And this is generally the range when we have, it's when a lot of the action was going on. You know, life was single-celled for a long time. It was doing a lot of good stuff, creating an oxygen atmosphere, working away at these biogeochemical cycles shaping the planet. But then about 540 million years ago, you had this boom, this explosion of multicellular, complex, advanced life, moving away from just these little single-celled critters or very simple interactions of single-celled critters to things that are much more complex, many, many cells working together as an organism. And then the evolution, the change of those multicelled life forms over this period. So this is the exciting period. Some people who study other things might not agree with that. But, you know, this is what people think of as evolution, the change of life. That's this whole period here. So in studying that, people have looked at, well, how many different types of fossil life, different types of species fossilized in the record do we see at any given time? And in particular, they tend to look at ocean life more often, because in the oceans, things tend to fossilize easier. Something just dies up on land and it's just exposed to the open air, it's less likely to get fossilized. If things die and fall on the sea floor and then get covered in sediment, sand, whatever, it's easier for them to become fossils. So we tend to just have a much better record of the change of different species in the ocean versus on land. So in particular, this is the marine fossil diversity. So here we're looking at the total number of genera, you could think total number of different species found in the fossil record over time. First of all, you definitely see, you know, there's an overall process going on. It kind of rises, levels off, falls, and then really dramatically picks up in the last 100 million years. You definitely see certain spikes, rapid decreases. This is the famous extinction that took out the dinosaurs, so-called KT, mass extinction, 65 million years ago. So you could see this reflected even in the ocean. You know, you think of the dinosaurs getting taken out, right? You see these cartoon depictions of the dinosaurs looking up, and you see this giant asteroid coming in. But it also devastated ocean life as well. We can see there's a major, major drop all of a sudden in the fossil record. Back here, 70 million years ago, they found, you know, it's at about 2,000 different genera, distinct different types of life, different genera in the marine fossil record. Then all of a sudden, 65 million years ago, they see much less, right? Looks like less than 1,500. So that's a pretty significant drop. Anyway, and then obviously there's different types of life going on too, which we'll get into in a minute. So this is something that people can study for trying to get trends, get a sense of what is the process, what has happened in the development of life. And this is stuff that's been studied going back decades. You know, over time, the fossil record has gotten better. We've gotten more fossils, explored the ground more, so we've gotten an improved fossil record over time. But I think these types of studies, I think, really picked up, I don't know, I'm not a total expert, but 70s, 80s, I think they really started picking up in the 90s. We started to have a large enough record of the past history of fossil life to start to look for fluctuations and trends and variations in this fossil diversity record. So in 2005, a team out of Berkeley reanalyzed one of the best records available. And they did a couple things. One, they took out this longer term trend, which is illustrated here with this dotted blue line, if you can see that. They kind of removed that and said, well, let's just look at the variation above and below this longer term trend. And they came up with this. And what they showed is that there's a very strong, a very clear cycle of approximately about 60 million years in the increase and decrease of the number of distinct species or genera, to be more specific, in the fossil record. It's pretty interesting. Why is there a cycle? Why is there a regular period of increase and decrease in the number of types of distinct life over time? They also looked at it in another way. They just took what they called short-lived genera. So these are genera where the you only see them existing in the fossil record for less than 45 million years. So, you know, there's fossils of certain types of primitive ocean life where we still have the same types of life around today. They've been around for a long time. You look at these trilobites and different things. There's other things where they only appeared in a brief, shorter window. So they said, well, let's just look at this shorter window, these genera, these species that weren't around a whole long time, thinking that maybe the shorter lived species would reflect the kind of fluctuation, the up and down, the change in diversity over time. And just taking these shorter lived genera, you also see this clear indication of this pulsation, this cycle, also about 60 million years. the number of short-lived genera around any time. So, this particular period, you had a lot more species genera found in the fossil record there, which didn't last a whole long time. Here, you had fewer that didn't last a whole long time, and the ones you found in this time tended to be ones that lasted a lot longer. So this wasn't the first time that there's evidence for a cycle in extinctions or in variations in the fossil record in the history of life on Earth. But this is definitely the clearest and strongest evidence for this with the most complete data set that's been available. And since then, this has been debated and it's been reanalyzed. It's been reanalyzed even more recently, and it still shows a very strong indication of this 60 million year record in the fossil record of life on Earth. So the question is, what would be causing this cycle? What would be driving a 60 million year fluctuation in the types of life, the diversity, the number of different types of life here on Earth? And in this particular paper, they didn't really try and answer the question. They just said the cycle's there. And they went through a number of possible things that could correlate to the cycle, but didn't try and nail down any one as they thought was actually true. They just said it's there. These are the types of things that it could correlate with. And since then, there's been a lot of debate about what's the cause, et cetera. one thing that's been identified, it was identified in that first paper, other people have focused on this, is that this cycle in biodiversity does match very well this cycle of the bobbing of our solar system up and down, above and below the galactic plane. But notice that this biodiversity cycle is a 60 million year cycle. So the highest biodiversity down to the lowest biodiversity is 60 million years, which would indicate you're talking about one of these full periods of the oscillation from below up to above, back to below the galactic plane. So here would be when we have high biodiversity, then as we're increasing, as we're moving up through the plane, biodiversity is declining. It reaches its minimum. We're at the peak of our northern extent. And then as we begin to descend down back through the plane and into the southern extent, this whole trend is, this whole path is when the biodiversity is actually increasing. So the biodiversity matches this cycle very well, but it doesn't match on the 30 million year cycle, which is what we saw with the climate. But it matches very well with the 60 million year cycle. So that's a provocative question we want to take up today. And there's two ways this can be approached. One, I guess you could generally call it a reductionist approach, where you're basically assuming we already know that life is just a product of complex chemistry. Complex chemistry is just a product of basic physics. We already know all the fundamental principles. We might not know all the details about how the interactions occur and why you get these amazing complex processes existing in the Earth or in the universe and on Earth. But we can know a priori that anything we find out about life, how life behaves, why it exists the way it exists, is just ultimately going to be a product of the principles of chemistry and those being a product of the principles of basic physics. More can be said. That's, you know, an attempt to briefly define what I would call maybe a reductionist approach. So in that mindset, you know, people look basically for what kind of, really what kind of kill mechanisms can exist? What can happen as the solar system's moving through the galaxy to, I think the technical term is to fuck a lot of stuff up. You know, what can asteroid impact, cosmic ray, star exploding, you know, what can just wreak havoc to just kill a bunch of stuff periodically that's connected to how our solar system moves through the galaxy, which can explain this biodiversity cycle correlating with the galactic motions. What I think is more interesting, a better approach, is to pick up off of the work of Vernadsky. In very much a non-reductionist approach. And look at this as evidence for new principles about how life exists in the universe, new fundamental principles, which can give us a higher understanding of what life is, how the universe operates, how the galaxy operates, and not just assume a priori that's just going to be a product of our already known basic principles. So that's the theme of this class here, where the taking a break from, and all the literature that's out there attempting to explain this is in a one variation of this reductionist approach, looking for these kill mechanisms. So we'll actually look at Vernadsky's approach instead, and I think is a very provocative, what I think for many academics would be a very uncomfortable or enraging perspective of looking at how this could be an expression of a new insight into how life exists as a principle in the universe more generally. But, and here's this graphic again. But to to really understand that, to grasp that, I want to take just a brief second to really look at what is it we're looking at when we look at this process. So we're looking at this biodiversity change, fossil diversity change over time. So you see overall, on the overall trend, there's an increase. There's an increase in the number of distinct types of life we find in the fossil record. I don't want to spend too long on this, but maybe just to get a sense of what we're talking about. This is just to see how this is often measured. And if there's any questions as we go, we can take them up. I mean, instead of waiting till the end, so if people have questions or thoughts, just throw them out. But just to get a sense of how some of this is looked at, here's the standard taxonomic classification system for life. So species are down here. So we tend to think of different types of species. Species that are believed to be similar, related, are classed in this higher order, what we were looking at before, this level of a genus or genera. So we were actually measuring in that fossil record the distinct number of different genera around. So here's just a couple examples that we might be familiar with just to get a sense of the breakdown. Genus is then subsumed by a family. Families are subsumed by orders. Orders by classes. Classes by phylums. Phylums by different kingdoms. So here we have dogs. Everyone likes dogs. We have a particular type of rat snake we happen to have around where I live. And we have these lovely little stink bugs that have made a presence on the East Coast past decade or so, an increasing presence. If you're in the Virginia, D.C., Maryland area, you're probably very familiar with these little stink bugs that invade every inch of your house they can get into every winter. All of these are animals. Dogs and snakes are vertebrates, certain broad type of life, whereas stink bugs are arthropods, they're not vertebrates. So those are different phylums, different phyla. If we look at the next distinction, the next type of lower order distinction, we have different types of classes. Well, both dogs and snakes are both vertebrates. They both have an internal skeleton. They have a spinal column, but they're different classes. Dogs are mammals. Snakes are reptiles. And these stink bugs are a particular class within arthropods, insects. Spiders are arthropods, but they're of a different class than insects. Arthropods tend to have this external skeleton. So crabs, stink bugs, spiders, all arthropods, all certain. So there's obviously a very big difference between this type of body design and this type of body design. An internal skeleton, soft tissue on the outside, an external skeleton, kind of a shelled. So anyways, you have the biggest differences up here in different kingdoms. So all these are animals. Another kingdom is plants. Plants is a separate kingdom. So the point is the biggest distinction in types of life are, you know, up here in the kingdom, phylum, classes. And then as you move down, you tend to get organisms that are similar, have more similarities, but smaller differences distinguishing their difference. You know, to the point where you get to different species, you know, you have tons of different types of species of snakes, and they're, you know, one's got a ring on its tail that's brown, another one's got a ring on its head that's gray, and now there's two different species or something. The differences are very minimal. So anyway, so you're looking at how these biodiversity records are looking at how you get increases and decreases in the number of different types of life. And in this case, we're looking at genera. Other studies can look at, you know, say families or something. So this is tetrapods, vertebrates, basically stuff that falls within this phylum, not all of it, but largely that phylum. So here's another example, the same period, 500 million years. Here we're looking at the number of different families instead of genera within different classes. So again, all these are vertebrates. I believe this particular study is looking at land-based records. So yeah, within the amphibians class, a rise in the number of different types of families and a decline. That decline was then followed by a rise in the number of different types of reptiles, number of different families of reptiles, which then rose for a while, and they kind of ended their reign at the KT mass extinction when the dinosaurs left us. And you had these other two classes take up their rise, mammals and birds. So here you can kind of see, while there's an overall dramatic rise in the biodiversity, it's also associated with a transition from kind of a dominance of amphibian type life, then a mass extinction, then a transition into the dominance of reptilian forms of life, dinosaurs, which had their reign, and there's a mass extinction, and then the transition to mammalian and bird forms of life being the dominant forms of life on the planet in terms of their relation to the food chain and what have you. So within this overall rise and change in biodiversity, we also have this shift, this transition to higher and higher forms of life. What you technically could classify as an anti-entropic process, a process moving towards higher degrees of complexity, higher degrees of energy flux density, more advanced systems. Just to illustrate this one other way, here we're looking at not just total numbers, but percentages here back to the ocean life. Again, the same period, 500 million years and all the fun stuff's happening. The shifting percentage of the number of types of species which have higher rates of energy use, higher metabolic rates, are part of a higher energy flux density system versus those with lower rates, lower energy flux density. So again, this is just another reflection, another illustration in the data, in the record. You look at, for this whole time period, generally what percentage of the number of species that we find in the fossil record are classified as having higher metabolic rates, higher energy flux density, higher energy usage. And we can see there's variation, but it's rather remarkable. It tends to stay at a pretty steady level of around, what's that, about 70%. And you know, we could see there's a change in the overall absolute numbers, but within these absolute numbers, the percentage actually stays remarkably stable, which is interesting. Then you had this mass extinction, literally called the mother of all mass extinctions. I didn't make that one up. The Permian-Triassic mass extinction, often thought to be the most devastating mass extinction on record. So you had this huge change, huge collapse in biodiversity, large change in the types of life that existed. Again, this is like the reign of the amphibians, roughly speaking. And this is more the reign of the reptiles. So in parallel with that transition on land, in the ocean, we see this transition to looking at all forms of animal life we have in the fossil record, we see this transition to a significantly higher percentage, now about 50%. So going from like 30% to 50% of all the species in the fossil record being classified as higher energy use, higher energy flux density, what Vernadsky would call higher rate of biogenic migration of atoms, a higher rate of transforming the biosphere and the surface of the planet by the action of life. And again, a period of stability, which is rather interesting because, again, the total amount is changing significantly, going up and down, but this percentage, the ratio, tends to stay about the same, which is kind of interesting. And then our other very big mass extinction, dinosaurs, they're out of here. You have a significant change and then a new kind of plateau, a new leveling off. We're now the majority now, you know, 60+%, 65% of the types of ocean life found in the fossil record are classified as having this higher energy flux density. So all that is to say, it's not just a random process. There's certainly a direction in the evolution process, a direction of moving towards higher energy flux density, higher rate of power and capability of life to transform the planet at a faster rate and sustain more advanced, more complex forms of life. So there's a certain direction to this whole process here. So we're not just looking at what, so we're saying what, if we want to understand the relation between these cycles of our motion through the galaxy and the development of life, we should, again, we're looking at what is this development of life that we're looking at. It's got this fluctuation to it. It's also got a certain directionality to it. And there's a lot to be said. I do want to mention one other thing, which is the when you go to these scales and these types of transitions, these emergence and disappearance of these higher levels of life, this is still not understood how this occurs. The standard idea is that evolution occurs by small changes on the species level. You'll get random mutations that'll, you know, randomly affect the production of offspring that are slightly different. If that mutation happens to be beneficial, that offspring will do better, and then slowly over time, that it's often presented, that's how evolution occurs on the whole. Well, we see some of that on the small level. You see species changing. You see variations on a small scale. When you look at these longer term trends in the fossil record, you don't see gradual species change and then gradual change in genuses and then gradual change in families. And then as a product of that, gradual change in orders. You just don't see that in the fossil record. You don't see evidence for that type of bottom-up driven character to the development of life. Probably the most famous and clearest example is the so-called Cambrian explosion, where when the action started, when things got exciting right around here, we didn't see evidence for a couple species of advanced multicellular life slowly changing into more genuses, more families, more orders, more classes. We kind of saw the inverse. We saw all of a sudden in a geological instant, and they have this now down to a few million years, you had no complex life of this type. Then all of a sudden you had all the different phylums appeared in the fossil record almost, and really in geological terms, instantaneously. So you have what the fossil record shows us is the highest order changes appeared most quickly, most rapidly. And that's still completely not understood how or why that occurs. So we didn't see one type of multi-celled life which slowly split and then slowly got more different and more different and more different and more different until finally one of them had an internal skeleton and the other one had an external skeleton, right? That's not something that happens from one random genetic mutation. You know, you don't have something that has an internal skeleton all of a sudden give birth to a offspring that has an exoskeleton, right? It's a very big change in the overall structure of the body, the morphology, etc. But we don't see evidence for those large-scale changes coming out of gradual changes on the smaller scale. We see it happen almost instantaneously in the so-called Cambrian explosion. We had all the different phyla, also very rapidly the different classes emerging as distinct forms of life. So the point of all that is that there's certain characteristics and open questions and anomalies about the evolution of life itself, which we should have in mind when we're looking at this fascinating relation between the galaxy and our motion through the galaxy and this process of the development of life. And instead of positing that we already know basically how life evolves and trying to look for explanations for how things might get killed and fucked up by galactic influences as explained in this record, we're going to take it the other way and say, well, maybe we have to look at something about this galactic relationship to actually understand the real nature of the development of life as we see it presented in the fossil record and the evidence. An anti-entropic process, having a direction to it, moving to higher energy flux density, higher rates of activity, and seemingly organized from the top down, not from the bottom up. Where the overall direction and the large-scale changes appear to be coming in as governing factors rather than simply products of small-scale changes over time. So anyways, that's, and a lot can be said, obviously, about life, the development of life. I think those are a couple important things to keep in mind when we come back to this. We're not going to assume that we know how this evolution process occurred. We want to lay out these broad general characteristics of the process and then reapproach this question of how our relation in the galaxy relates to that from that standpoint. Now, the reductionist approach, I mean, I've seen a few things, maybe I'll just put them out there just for reference, to explain why you'd get a relationship between changing biodiversity patterns in a cyclical fashion and the cycles of our motion through the galaxy. There's been a few things posed. Earlier on, before the most recent record showed a very strong 60 million year cycle, wasn't as clear how long the cycle was. People thought they saw this when the fossil record just wasn't as good. We didn't have as many samples. You're not working with as much. They're constantly improving the dating system itself, pinpointing how old different things are. So it's very much an evolving process. But back in the 80s, two rather well-known scientists, a guy named Raup and a guy named Sepkoski, found what they thought was about a 26 million year cycle in the fossil record. And I actually don't know who posed it initially. Well, in asking why would we get a cycle in the fossil record like that, somebody said, well, maybe our star is part of a binary system. And there's another very faint star, or maybe even really big planet, that has a huge elliptical orbit. So, and it takes maybe 26 million years for that tiny, very dim star to make a full orbit around our sun, which I think many people think that'd be hard to exist, but that was posited. And it was thought that maybe when that small star or large planet came around and passed the perihelion, its closest pass to the sun, maybe it made it pass through the Oort cloud. We talked about this thing in the first or the second class, and perturbed some of these comets and sent in a comet shower and increased the rate at which comets were piling into the inner solar system. So it'd be more likely to get an impact, more likely to get a mass extinction from an impact from an asteroid or a comet in this case. And that could be controlled periodically by the orbit of this other star around our star. And they said, well, what would we name this other star? And they said they'd name it Nemesis. So that's the Nemesis hypothesis. And I've never thought it worthwhile to follow up any of these claims about Planet X and Nibiru and all this stuff people throw around the internet about some object barreling into the solar system that's, you know, already past Jupiter, but NASA's hiding it from us, and somehow no one will be able to see that. there's a lot of crazy stuff. If you haven't heard about this, then just pretend I didn't say it and don't waste your time. But it sounds like some of this kind of came off of trickling off of this more interesting question about what would cause this periodic extinction. And maybe it's a binary star system. So anyways, that's one kind of reductionist approach for why would you get biodiversity, fossil variation in this cyclical fashion, looking for certain astronomical influences. More recently, when this study was put out showing this clear 60 million year cycle, you know, one group posed that maybe this northern side of the galaxy experiences a higher flux of very, very high energy extragalactic cosmic radiation. Maybe caused by the fact that they think our whole galaxy is moving in that direction through the intergalactic medium. So when the solar system's up here, we're just getting pummeled with very high energy radiation. Animals are getting cancer. They're going extinct. All kinds of bad stuff. So the biodiversity record goes down. I don't know how that would explain variations in certain types of ocean life. Maybe they're also susceptible to very high energy cosmic radiation. But then we move back down through the galactic plane. Okay, now we're shielded. Down here we're safe. Life can expand again. You get an increase in the biodiversity record. So that's another hypothesis. an extragalactic cosmic ray shock front hypothesis. Other people are coming along and they say, well, we haven't applied dark matter to this question yet, so maybe it's just dark matter. And it's been posed that maybe as the solar system's passing through the galactic plane, certain types of mysterious fundamental particles, which we don't yet understand, which make up dark matter, actually get gravitationally attracted to the core of our Earth, pile up in the core of our Earth, annihilate against each other somehow. And supposedly they have all kinds of actual physics models for what these particles should do and behave and all kinds of stuff. And then cause a heating of the core of the Earth, which would cause more volcanism, which would blow more, you know, ash and volcanoes and all kinds of bad stuff periodically as we pass through the midplane of our galaxy. And there's your mechanism to have a bad day, screw things up, etc. So that's another, I would say, reductionist hypothesis for how to explain this relation between this periodic nature of the biodiversity record and our motion through the galaxy. You know, and again, there's many of these mass extinctions correlate with massive volcanic activity. So, you know, they're not just pointing to nothing. There is very interesting, huge volcano. It's not even like volcanoes, like the Earth crust like splits open and you have these massive flows of lava that will cover thousands of square miles over thousands of years. And those tend to happen during some of these mass extinctions. So they say, well, you know, if we don't know what it is, it's probably dark matter. It's got these properties, et cetera. So that's, anyway, so those are, from what I've seen, some of the leading reductionist attempts to explain this correlation. But I think the biggest problem with all of this is that you don't just have a cycle in extinction events. You have a cycle when you look at extinction and origination together, origination being the generation of new species, the creation of new species. So it's not just a periodic wipeout of life. It's a period of life diversity decreasing and increasing and decreasing and increasing. And some people that have criticized and attempted to claim that this cycle doesn't even exist have only looked at the extinction record. And they say, if we just look at extinction data, we don't see evidence for a strong cycle. And the authors of this paper and other people looking at this replied, well, yeah, you don't just look at the extinction record. You look at extinction and origination and the periods of rapid increase, periods of increasing diversity, increasing different types of life. So I think that I think adds really one of the most important elements in the record itself to really take a different approach to this thing. We're not just looking at periodic catastrophic wipeouts. We're looking at, there's a few major wipeouts, a few major mass extinctions. But I think what's most interesting about the mass extinctions is they're characterized by a transition from a fundamentally lower to a higher level of the system of life as a whole. So these wipeouts and these extinctions themselves are, you know, more like a transition process in an anti-entropic development. But even aside from the extinctions, you have a cycle of extinction and origination governing this overall development process. So I think the question is not simply what bad guys are lurking out there in the galaxy that can wreak havoc periodically, but recognizing life as a top-down anti-entropic process on the planet, what might that tell us about our galaxy such that this development process of life itself is resonating with certain characteristics about our relation to the galaxy? If you want to ask that question, take this kind of top-down approach, the work of Vernadsky is critical. And in particular, one of our colleagues, Megan Roulard, translated a paper of his from 1931, I think. There's debate. I think it was 30, but anyway. A very interesting paper by Vernadsky, where he, in certain respects, takes up this question and I think poses some very critical thoughts which apply directly to what we're looking at now with these current studies. And it's a decent-sized paper. I'm not going to attempt to summarize the whole thing at all. But his basic thesis is that science is going very much in the wrong direction by, he doesn't call it reductionism, but by attempting to define what he calls our scientific picture of the cosmos, our scientific understanding of the universe as a whole. He says when you go to these questions about from the standpoint of science, what do we know about the universe itself, our understanding of the cosmos itself. He says for certain reasons, and he points to Newton, he points to Laplace in particular, for certain reasons, when you go to these larger questions, things like life are just left out. And it's all this total bottom-up reductionist approach. You know, and Laplace, follower of Newton, you know, had his famous presentation of this idea. It's often referred to as Laplace's demon, where he said, if you could know just the position and the velocity of every single particle in the universe, that would tell you everything about the universe as a whole. So all you need to know about everything in the universe is just the positions and the velocities and the laws of interactions between fundamental particles, and that's it. And he said, if you had some magical force, some being that could know all that and calculate all that to the infinite precision, he would know all of the past and all of the future. Because everything is determined, you know, including what you do, what you might think you have free will to decide what you want to do tomorrow, but really, it's just because every single fundamental particle that makes up every molecule, that makes up every part of you, has a certain position and direction, and therefore that's determining what you're even thinking and how you're thinking, etc. rather crazy view. So this, you know, Vernadsky cites this directly as evidence for where he's saying science has gone way wrong in the acceptance and spread of this idea of a total bottom-up deterministic conception of the scientific nature of the universe as a whole. And he says, well, we should look to things like life to tell us fundamental things about the nature of the universe as a whole. And he's quite interested in the shift that's occurring that has begun during his lifetime with the developments of Einstein and Planck. And he said, well, this kind of opens up a new perspective where, you know, certain fundamental ideas that went into this previous scientific picture of the cosmos, as he called it, are being overturned, overthrown. You know, when you get down to the very small levels, you can't know exactly both the position and momentum of a particle itself. So you can't have this kind of totally 100% defined deterministic view. So he says these types of things are now showing us that that whole idea, which itself was already fraudulent, that all that idea that was introduced by Newton and Laplace is now being overturned. But in a sense, he's saying, let's not just stay in the domain of physics now, though. Let's look to the properties of life itself as giving us new insights into the real scientific picture of the cosmos as a whole. So that's kind of his general thesis to the paper as a whole. And you can get a copy of this if you just search The Study of Life and the New Physics. You can find it. We published it. It is an excellent paper. I think one of the best things I've read by Vernadsky, both in his own scientific views and is also his insight into the attacks on science, problems in science that have led us down certain wrong paths, and his insight into where we should go to correct those problems. So it's an excellent paper. But, you know, again, we can... So he dedicates mostly the first half of this paper to kind of developing and elaborating his thesis, that idea. At about the midway point, maybe two-thirds of the way through, he starts to look at life more directly in more detail. And he's got this rather interesting section where he has two, he says, okay, well, let's look, if we want to look at how the study of life can inform us about the nature of the cosmos, the scientific picture of the cosmos as a whole, let's examine what are the properties of life that we know of. He says, if we want to do that, let's look at two classes of types of properties, what he calls planetary properties of life and what he calls non-planetary properties of life. And I think, you know, from my reading of Vernadsky, you know, I think this reflects, you know, something he was very careful about in his language and his investigations, where he would distinguish between, you know, studying the expressions of life that we have here on Earth versus saying you're studying life per se, life itself. He says, we're looking at the expression of life on the surface of the Earth, which has certain characteristics. We're looking at the expression of life in what he called the geochemical or biogeochemical medium, the elements that make up the Earth's crust, the energy coming in from the sun, the gases of the atmosphere, etc. There's a certain chemical energetic medium in which we see life expressing itself. So we can study life as we see it expressed in this medium. We can identify some properties of life as we're seeing it expressed in this medium, which we can say are properties of the medium itself, or properties that are at least characterized by or defined by the fact that this is the medium, this is the basis in which we see life expressing itself. But then he also says there's certain properties, certain characteristics about life, which life as we see it expressed in the biogeochemical medium, which we cannot attribute to anything about that medium itself, and which instead might tell us about the nature of life per se, not just how we see life expressing itself in this particular context here on Earth in the biosphere, but they might tell us something about life as a more general principle of the universe. So a few examples. planetary properties of life. You know, there's something like 10 examples he gives, just to pull out a couple. He says, for example, one, living matter is created and maintained on our planet by the cosmic energy of the sun. There it forms an integral part of the upper geosphere, the Earth, the biosphere, as an indissoluble part of its mechanism. So as we see life expressing itself here on Earth, it's powered by the energy of the sun, and it's expressed in this as an integrated part of the upper layer of the Earth's crust. Or he gives another planetary property. He said, living matter enters in the course of all geological time in a uniform way, by way of the biogeochemical cycles of the chemical elements in the Earth's crust, while playing a very important role there. In this way, living matter provides a determined biogeochemical energy in the migration of terrestrial chemical elements, of which the primary source comes principally from the sun. You know, and this is something pertaining to what he studied a lot of, which is how life changes the chemical structure of the Earth, moves chemical elements around. He often uses the term biogenic migration of atoms, how atoms are moved around and changed into different chemical, different molecular formations by the action of life. But again, this property of life as we see it expressed here, you know, is directly tied to what we know about the medium itself. You get a source of energy from the sun. There's certain chemical elements which are characteristic of the surface of the Earth, and so we see certain properties of life, which again are reflecting the planetary nature of the medium within which we're studying life expressing itself here on Earth. But then he says you have certain properties again, which are properties we see expressed in this manifestation of life, but properties which we cannot attribute to the medium itself. And again, he lists something like 10, give or take, different properties. The one he spends most of the rest of the paper discussing is this idea of dissymmetry, that living processes tend to favor a left-handed or right-handed form of molecules. Something which isn't the case just in the geochemical nature of the Earth itself or non-living processes on the Earth. We don't find some, rock formation or something, which is made of molecules that all have one hand versus the other. We see it, if there are non-living processes that make elements that can have a left-handed or right-handed character, or molecules that can have a left-handed or right-handed characteristic, they're made equally in both parts. With life, we see a unique feature where life predominantly relies upon just one hand versus the other. You know, and this is one, just people are not familiar. So here you have a particular molecular compound, and you can see it's made of all the same chemical elements. The only difference is how they're arranged. They're relative to each other. They're all arranged the same way also, but they have a different orientation relative to each other. You could say one's left-handed versus one's right-handed, just like your hands. Your hands both have the same, at least for most of us, both have the same number of fingers, thumbs. They're oriented relative to each other the same way, but they're mirrored. You can't directly impose them one on the other. If you hold them together like this, now what's top for one and bottom is flipped for the other one. If you try and keep the top and the bottom the same, now they don't line up the same way. So certain molecules can have left and right forms. From what we know about non-living processes, or as Vernadsky is discussing it here, the planetary medium as we see it expressed, there's nothing in that itself which points us towards any reason why one hand versus another might be preferred. But in life, you see this expressing itself. Life relies on distinguishing from one hand versus the other. So throughout much of his work, he's very focused on this as a very important and enlightening aspect about studying life, which can tell us a lot. And in this particular work, he looks at this as a so-called non-planetary property of life, or a property of life that, again, we can't just explain as a consequence of the medium within which we see life expressing itself, but which is there. And therefore, he says, maybe this property, and the other properties he lists here too, and this, again, he's got about 10 properties, but he focuses mostly on this one for the rest of the paper. Perhaps this can tell us something about life per se, rather than just life as we see it manifested in the geochemical medium on the Earth's crust, in the biosphere. And he's got this conclusion, which I love, to this list, which would freak out a lot of reductionists, I think. But he says this list, referring to the non-planetary properties, this list is not complete, but it indicates with evidence that life manifests itself in the cosmos in other forms than those which biology normally displays. So he's saying if we have life expressing itself here on Earth, and we see properties of life express itself here on Earth, which cannot be just attributed and explained away as a consequence of the medium, that those indicate that there's something else acting, something else as a principle, an active principle, rather than just a consequence of the medium in which it exists. And if that principle exists as an independent principle, we should be looking for the expressions of that principle in the universe more generally. And our scientific perception of the cosmos as a whole, our scientific insight into the universe as a whole, should include considerations of these types of things. Certain principles about life per se, which we cannot just explain away as a consequence of a reductionist approach, which therefore indicate us that these expressions, these principles, are something about the nature of the universe itself as a whole. So dissymmetry, the idea that there's a distinction between left versus right. We see it expressed in life as life expresses itself on Earth. And if we want a more truthful and more accurate scientific picture of the cosmos as a whole, these are the types of properties we should be looking for, expressing themselves in various ways in the cosmos more generally. And he's got this other quote from a different paper, which I also like, which brings us back to the focus of this class here after taking a tour through the evolution of life, a tour through some of Vernadsky's work, an idea of Vernadsky's approach to the study of these questions, and then come back to our question about the galaxy. And so this is a paper he wrote around the same time, 1931 here. Megan Roulard also translated this for us, on the conditions of the appearance of life on Earth. And he's got an interesting quote here, section, where he says, "The spiral form of nebulae and of some stellar agglomerations indicates the probable presence of analogous dissymmetrical phenomena in the cosmos." Now this is 31, so nebulae and stellar agglomerations are basically galaxies. This was still fresh when they were first realizing that we're part of one kind of closed, not closed, but kind of one separated system that we can define as a galaxy. And there's actually other distinct systems out there, which are other galaxies. You know, back when the telescopes weren't as good, you know, you're first starting to look at these things, they weren't sure if everything wasn't just part of our galaxy. You know, you have nebulae, you have structures within our galaxy which are nebulous and they can have certain structures and features. They saw these spiral looking ones, and a lot of people just thought, well, those are just also parts within our galaxy, within our system. And it wasn't until really the 20s we started to get some real conclusive evidence showing us that no, these are actually things like our system but outside of our system. They're other galaxies. So sometimes these would be called spiral nebulae, or they'd be called stellar agglomerations. So those are galaxies he's talking about there. So he says, "The spiral form of nebulae and some other stellar agglomerations indicates the probable presence of analogous dissymmetrical phenomena in the cosmos. If the right spirals predominate, in effect, clearly among the spiral nebulae, as numerous photographs attest, or in certain parts of the universe, right spiral nebulae are concentrated, and in other parts of the universe, left spiral nebulae, then the existence of dissymmetrical spaces in the cosmos would become more than probable. This dissymmetry would seem to be analogous to that which we observe in the space penetrated by life." So he's saying, if we look at these different galaxies and we see a predominance of one of them spiraling in one direction versus spiraling in the other direction, here's an example of two spiral galaxies as we observe them appearing to us spiraling in opposite directions. If we don't just see a random distribution of left and right spirals, but we see either overall more of one direction, or if we look in one part of the sky and we see one direction, we look in another part of the sky, we see a different direction. If we see something like that, that could indicate to us that the spiral nature of these galaxies could be some expression of dissymmetry, the preference for a certain handedness, a certain orientation, expressed in this in the cosmos on these larger scales, which could be analogous or similar to the type of dissymmetry preference for handedness which we see in life. And I'm quite curious as to what numerous photographs he's talking to, because I've never seen, I'm not sure exactly what they were looking at the time. Again, this was 1931, so might have just been a small sampling bias at the time, but certainly interesting. I would add that only within the last 10 years, some other studies have come out that actually do find this. They find if you look at one particular direction in the sky, you get a small but certainly significant increase in the number of galaxies, spirals we see spinning in one direction. And if we look in the exact opposite direction in the sky, so the exact polar opposite direction, you see them spinning the other way. It's a pretty interesting study. So maybe Vernadsky's certainly onto something there. But you see him looking, looking at these spiral-handed structures in these galaxies and looking for, maybe some kind of indication of the presence of this principle of dissymmetry expressing itself on a larger scale in a different medium, in a different context, but maybe sharing some similarity to what governs the expression of life as we see it here on Earth. Now, to conclude, to come back to what this points to for us in these recent studies of the biodiversity record, the cycles in the biodiversity record, the development of life, the cycles in the anti-entropic development of life, corresponding to our motion above and below the galaxy. If you're going to hypothesize and say that our galaxy maybe itself has a governing dissymmetrical characteristic, let's hypothesize and say life, in a sense, is being expressed, the principle of life is being expressed in some way in the organization of our galaxy as a whole. And it's being expressed in the existence of some preference or some inherently dissymmetrical characteristic to the system as a whole. If you're going to make that hypothesis, which I think would be the direction to go based on Vernadsky's work and where this life, these cycles of evolution point to us, it would mean that you'd have to distinguish between the top and the bottom of a galaxy. Because if you just have a spiral galaxy and you want to say, is this spiral galaxy left-handed versus right-handed? Well, right away you could just say, well, your determination is what side of the galaxy you're looking at it from. If I'm looking at this galaxy here, I see it, spiraling this way. If I could step behind this screen and look at it, I'd see it spiraling the other way. So I could just say, well, whether I call it left or right just depends on where I'm looking at it from. Well, if there's something that distinguishes between top and bottom, something that distinguished this side versus the other side, there's something in its organization as a whole, in its existence as a whole, that expressed that, then you'd have something you could absolutely define as having a character of either left-handed or right-handed, having some dissymmetry in its organization as a unity as a whole. Just like your hand, I see the thumb pointing to the right when I'm looking at it this way. I see it pointing to the left when I'm looking at it this way. But I also know now I'm looking at the bottom of my hand, which is different because that's where my fingers fold towards. I can't do that same thing this way. At least most people can't. If you can, you might need to see a doctor or something. So my hand has a handedness. It's got a clear top and bottom which can be distinguished, such that I can say this is my left hand, this is my right hand. So if you're going to say a single galaxy has a dissymmetrical characteristic, you'd have to have something which would distinguish that. Distinguish top versus bottom in this sense. And that's exactly what you see in the fossil record itself. And this is actually why some people of the reductionist camp, tend to try and dismiss or ignore the idea that the changes in the evolution of life are actually reflecting something about our motion through the galaxy. Because they say, well, why If it's just something about the galaxy, it should be a 30 million year cycle. You know, maybe it's something that happens every time you cross the midplane. Maybe it's something every time you, maybe it's something that happens every time either you're above or below the plane. Because in their framework, there's nothing really that significantly distinguishes, from the standpoint of kill mechanisms, the top versus the bottom. Again, there's the one theory about the high energy extragalactic cosmic rays, you know, frying everybody when we're up there. So that's one attempt for an external, extrinsic differentiation of the conditions in the north versus the south. But again, you know, the records don't just show a kill mechanism or an extinction variation. They show a variation in extinction and origination in the creation of new species in a process that is top-down determined and moving in a certain direction. And if we're looking for the expressions of non-planetary properties of life, informing us about the principles of organization of the universe as a whole, well, we would certainly expect that those conditions or those properties would be most strongly reacted to by the expressions of life we have here on Earth. And that is what the fossil record shows. It's when we're moving in this direction, moving north out of the northern plain, that you tend to get the decline in the biodiversity record. And it's when we're moving south down into the southern region, you tend to get the increase in the biodiversity record. So I think the Vernadskyan hypothesis, a non-reductionist Vernadskyan approach to this question, I think opens up some rather fascinating frontier questions about what he was calling for, which is looking for the expressions of life as a principle expressing itself in other forms in the cosmos more generally. And indicating that our galaxy itself, as a singular system, could be organized by this having a certain inherent dissymmetrical characteristic to it, such that the experience, the process of development of life on Earth resonates with that changing relationship to the galaxy in this dissymmetrical fashion. And that being the direction to look for understanding the relation between the cycles in the biodiversity record and the cycles of our motion through the galaxy. And then if we're taking that path, you know, this top-down investigation of the question, I think, you know, the other thing to do is to then invert the question. So why not then also take the development of life itself on Earth as evidence for how we think about what we know about the galaxy itself as a whole, as a single system? That if life is resonating as a top-down driven anti-entropic development process on Earth with a dissymmetrical resonance with the galaxy, then, you know, that points to that indicates to us that the galaxy itself, you know, should be viewed as an anti-entropic top-down driven process. If life itself is resonating, is certain showing certain resonant characteristics with this galactic relationship, then we should be taking those characteristics and asking the question, well, how much do those reflect the resonant system of which they're responding to as a whole? So I think that's the Vernadsky approach, the top-down approach. You know, again, we're looking at this huge swath of the development of life, 500 million years, and how that as an anti-entropic process seems to resonate with our galactic motion. And I think, you know, this should be, these are the types of questions, you know, as Vernadsky posed explicitly, that we should be pursuing and taking up for a non-reductionist scientific picture of the cosmos, as he called it. You know, our understanding of the universe as a whole, as itself containing or expressing or being organized by, you know, properties of life as a anti-entropic developing process, as we see it expressed here on Earth. And so, and that's our home. That's where we live in. So if you want to know your neighborhood, you want to know where you come from, you want to know where you're going, you know, these are the types of things that are the real frontier questions that we should be getting into. So, take up any questions or discussion. I don't know if I paid any ringers today for questions, but ran out of cash. So.
Where do the mass extinctions fit in the up and down in the overall biodiversity cycle?
Near the northern peaks. So they tend to occur in this range here.
Could you go back to the chart that shows them on the biodiversity? So they're when it's going down anyway. Not they're like, you know, there was they sort of fit in with it in that way.
Yeah, and this is a little bit funny. So this is a 30 million year cycle. So this is here's the Permian Triassic mass extinction. This is happening right near this would be the northern peak. So when we're down here, we're on the northern peak. And then we're moving down, here's crossing the midplane, and then here's reaching the southern peak in our travel through the galaxy. Here's reaching the midplane again, here's reaching the northern peak, midplane, southern peak. So the cycle is twice as is expressed here.
I mean, it looks like there's a period of 60 million years to go from the bottom back to the bottom on this, right?
Is it maybe?
Well, if I look at the years on the bottom, yeah, that's 60.
Oh, yeah, no, you're right. I'm sorry. Yeah, I was thinking about this one. Sorry. Sorry, you're right. Yes, anyway, so we'll take that out. We'll take that out in post, as they say. Sorry, say again.
I was just curious. So the mass extinctions occur when it's going down anyway. I mean, it's not like there's a lot to look at, but the couple that we see here, they didn't occur in the middle of it going up, and then all of a sudden there's a mass extinction.
Uh-huh.
They occurred at periods of decreasing biodiversity.
Yeah, I mean, you already see kind of a trend down before you see the really sharp hit of the mass extinction.
Also, do you know how close the phase of this lines up with the... So there's a blue... You know, there's a dashed line that we're seeing in that chart. You said that the peaks of biodiversity run with the southern extremity below the galactic plane. How, you know, like how close is that, like right when we're right at the bottom of the galactic plane? Like, do the phases align pretty darn well? You know how off they are, how close they are?
I had compared them. I don't have a graphic comparing them right here. I don't know how. I mean, they certainly line up pretty well. As you start to go further back in time, you know, the error range tends to increase a little bit, so it's a little more difficult. But if we were to overlay the cycle of the solar system's motion through the galaxy over that blue line, they would line up very well.
So since we're, according to the blue line, a low period of biodiversity, I mean, obviously it's easy to discover more things recently, you know, since we're at a low part in that cycle of biodiversity, that means that we're close to the northern peak above the galactic plane, in other words.
Yeah, we're heading north now, yeah. Okay. And then, you know, this is also interesting because this is kind of you see some of the mass extinctions expressed here too in the short lived, but you also just see kind of this more general pulsation in the, you know, I think the idea being these shorter lived genera, you know, kind of indicating the rate of creation of new species versus not creation of as many new species. So the fact you get this fluctuation in the number of short-lived ones that are around, I think, is also interesting, kind of independent expression of this cyclical characteristic. Yeah. And, you know, the mass extinctions kind of play into this. They also, you know, you might want to also recognize them as not necessarily fully governed by and expressing this cyclical process as a whole. You know, they are unique in terms of their rapidity, the speed, the time. It's like a blink of an eye in geological time in which you get this rapid disappearance of species. So that exists as a phenomenon, you know, to a general degree lines up well with this. But I think, you know, this is showing something in addition to that, just a general trend of increase and decrease more as a continuous process as well. And then if we get hit with a giant comet, that might force the conditions where things change a little more rapidly for that period of time. You know, certainly worth recognizing that, but that might kind of be an added factor on top of the more general process we see.
Can you tell the direction that galaxies are moving in? Do we see motion of whole galaxies?
Very little, only in our local group. And I wish I had a nice 3D simulation program to fly around our local group. Very useful to get a sense of scale and relation, but like, you know, there's the big players in our local group are ourselves, the Milky Way, and Andromeda M31. Those are the big spirals. There's another spiral that's smaller but still nice, good looking spiral, clean structure, M33. It's kind of a little brother of Andromeda or something. And then around us, these guys, there's a bunch of little smaller ones. The Large Magellanic Cloud, the Small Magellanic Cloud, people might be familiar with those. Those are small, what they call dwarf or irregular galaxies. So they might show some kind of spiral structure, but you know, not as clean and coherent and fully organized. So there's a lot of those guys around, significantly smaller but distinct galaxies. So that's in our local group. You know, I think they're up to like 30, some odd 30 galaxies as part of our local group. So these ones we can actually measure, at least make some attempts to measure proper motion across the sky. There's attempts to measure the proper motion of M31, Andromeda. You know, admittedly, they're pretty rough. They give kind of quite a wide error range. But they think they have seen some very small but detectable amount of proper motion. I forget how much. You know, again, we're talking about few milli arc seconds per year, maybe even less micro arc seconds. I'm not totally sure. So for M31, you know, they do see a little bit of its proper motion. And then you can get the motion directly towards us or away from us from the Doppler shift. So when you combine those two, you can get a sense of the direction of M31 through space. Once we go outside of our local group, given how rough the proper motion M31 is. You make the next leap to other nearby groups, which are now another good fraction away, good, you know, further distance away. I would be very surprised if we can get any proper motion of them. We can get the recession, the Doppler shift, you know, because that's just the shift in the spectral lines for how much you're moving towards us or away from us. But being able to get its actual motion through space, I think right now we're just limited to the local group.
We can tell in relation to other things that this, our galaxy is moving perpendicular to its plane and not in any other direction.
This depends relative to what?
Yeah, that's what I mean.
Yeah. Relative to, yeah. I mean, the thing I think I've seen people look at a lot is our supposed idea of if we're moving towards M31. And that's why they're looking at the proper motion of M31. And again, you could say the proper, we observe a proper motion of M31. Is that M31 moving left to right relative to us, or us moving left to right relative to M31? You know, it's a combination of both, depending what you want to call your reference frame. But for that one, they're interested in that to know, well, is it moving towards us at this speed, but also moving this way at this speed, such that its motion is going to be like this? We're just going to miss each other. Or is it, you know, very little side motion and mostly towards each other and they'd actually hit? So that that's the place I've seen it discussed the most in terms of the proper motion of other galaxies.
In a previous class, you had talked about how using the motion of other stars relative to us could be used to gauge the motion of our sun in the galaxy. If you look at the red shifts of other galaxies and things around us, is there any overall direction that seems to show up?
That's a good question. I've seen, I've seen people try and look at that. It'd be fun to dig those papers back and look at them more closely. I mean, the first thing you see is that everything appears to be moving away from us, which is the whole expansion of space idea. And then again, I think it depends on what sets of objects you're looking at. I've seen people try and look at just quasars, which they think are really far away, and try and do a similar analysis to get our motion relative to the whole system. The other thing they look at is the cosmic microwave background, and they try and see how we're potentially moving relative to that. Stuff I haven't looked at, but I've seen referenced. So, you know, I think it depends on what stages of objects you're looking at and hypothesizing about what structures are part of out there. Yeah, but then yeah, and then also definitely with the local group, they've actually with the local group, yeah, they do that with the local group also, because then you don't have as much of the supposed expansion of space as a whole, because these are nearby neighbors, there's not as much space to be expanding between us. So they think those are good to look at to try and get a sense of how we're moving relative to them. I guess the other thing that comes up in any of that is to know the motion of our galaxy as a whole. We have to know really well the motion of our solar system around the galaxy really well. And that the error range in that is still to the point where it kind of overwhelms our ability to try and get a really precise measurement of our motion of the galaxy as a whole. So it's like, if it's like we're trying to measure how our sun is moving relative to another star, but we're not sure how the Earth's moving around the sun, right? All our measurements are from the Earth as we're going around the sun. So if we don't know that motion, you can't accurately take that away to get a sense of how our solar system as a whole is moving from the sun standpoint.
Now, if we're looking at the correlation of the movement going up and down the galaxy, north and south, it seems that people would be inclined to look into things about, like what you're saying, looking at what makes, at that time, certain life forms exist in a certain period of time and others live in another period of time. Now, if we look at something like maybe atmospheric conditions or maybe chemical composition of the ocean and all that kind of stuff, that may come into play. But why would it, even if it's north or south, or I don't know where all these different life forms appear, what is it that makes, why is it that gigantic dinosaurs lived in that time and then higher energy life forms live at that time and smaller ones live at that time,
mm-hmm.
even though they're both supposedly in the same upper or lower level, whichever one.
Right. Yeah.
What would incline people to look into to figure that out?
Uh-huh. I think I understand your question. I think the issue would be, what's the next progressive stage to be developed? So that.
Yeah. And also what would people start to look at?
Yeah. I mean, the other thing, not even really introducing, and it's a whole nother subject. I've only looked into it to really a relatively limited degree. The whole galaxy is changing too. There's certain actual records of cosmic ray activity and other things on Earth, which we think correspond to higher and lower rates of star formation, creations of more stars, overall development of the galaxy as a whole. I think if you want to get a little more fun and some of the more interesting questions, there's the issues of, which we'll get into, I think, in the next class, the issues of what actually governs the organization of a galaxy as a whole. Some of these questions of intrinsic redshift, indications that there's a certain unifying governing principle to organizing a galactic system as a single entity that we don't yet grasp or understand. And that being directly related to indications about how the galaxies are created, develop, evolve, and change. So we have some indications of, very roughly, that things were different when they might have been a little bit different. But we still don't know what governs the system as a whole. And we don't know how that governing principle has governed the changes in the developments of the galaxy as a whole. Which I think would, those questions obviously would pertain directly into this investigation here. So the question would be, what was the state of the galaxy here when the Cambrian explosion happened? We might know certain things about higher rates of star formation, less rates of star formation. Some of those hypotheses involve, various assumptions. Some of them come from better records. But I would insist that even just that would be scratching the surface, because we don't know what governs the galactic system as a whole. There's clear evidence of governing characteristics determining the state, maybe the space-time characteristics of the galaxy, which are completely anomalous to us. And so how those governing influences changed and have changed and what state they were at back here, those are getting into questions which we have no ability to even really answer until we start to really take a serious look at some of these questions about the real process of formation, development, creation of galaxies. But what we clearly see is, throughout this process, throughout the mass extinctions, we might kind of return to the same, not exactly the same, but the same, we return to the conditions of the southern region of the galaxy. Every time we have done that, the galaxy might have different characteristics because it's also changing and developing. But what we see consistently through this whole thing is that when we're down on a certain, on the southern region, that's when you see this impulse, this direction of move towards the next step, the next evolutionary step. You know, so it's not just, it's not just a cyclical process, but it's a cyclical process moving towards anti-entropic development. So I think if we want to understand the potential dissymmetrical organizing characteristics of the galaxy as a whole, we have to look at how life itself could be responding to that in its own development and change. Which, that train of thought poses a lot more questions than answers, but I think that's why we're here, to find the fun questions. So, I mean, I think just to, you know, reflect on this whole thing, I think Vernadsky's work really provides a very refreshing perspective on this whole investigation, and really just this step back. I mean, really, it, in a sense, it is kind of stepping out of the whole 19th century destruction of science that Mr. LaRouche keeps talking about, which is the hardcore imposition and forcing reductionism on the method of thought and scientific thought. And, you know, stepping outside that whole thing and looking through his eyes, his perspective, from somebody who's fighting against that attempt to destroy science, and really start from a non-reductionist top-down perspective towards investigating these questions. And I think, you know, these are the types of things that I think are just fascinating when you look at his work 85 years ago now. That's what he was saying 85 years ago. And it gives us a completely new perspective to look at questions today, which we have currently no answers for. But it gives a different basis for investigation that, you know, already provides more fruitful paths of pursuit, you know, provides coherence with the type of thing he was looking for. You know, I think the general idea, you know, I think what characteristic of, you call it space-time, maybe it's something even higher than how we think of space-time, of a dissymmetrical space-time organizing characteristic to the galaxy, the galactic system as an entirety. I think that's the type of thing that, you know, we want to increasingly look for the evidence of, the indications of the existence of that type of process, and seek that out. Anyway, the general idea is that, you know, we live in an anti-entropic universe. The question is figuring out how that process is fully mediated and expressed through different phase spaces, through different expressions, manifestations. And I think, you know, obviously we're doing this whole series, but I think understanding that points us to a necessity of taking up this issue, the question of the galaxy, as a necessary component, phase space stage of that mediated process of development of the universe more generally. And understanding what role does the galaxy play in that context, in that process. So that's probably a good place to leave it off, unless there's any other questions. So I can pay any more ringers to ask any more questions, but. Okay, so we'll be back with more, again, taking on these questions of the, you know, kind of stepping to a higher level and looking at the organization of galaxies as a whole. So that to look forward to. So thank you guys for coming.